So welcome to my speech, and I will just introduce myself. My name is Gabriel Alfonso. And I've been the chairman of the membership committee last year, for the last year. And we see for the next year, the new membership committee has just been elected. And so we have to decide soon who will be the next chair. But for the moment, I've been told that, officially I'm still the chair. Anyway, I'm here to talk about our community and about membership, which is something that is close to each other because usually we invite people from the community to join the foundation and to enrich our foundation in this way. So, where are we going? This is the agenda. We'll see what's the current situation. Where are the areas, countries where we are missing? Especially in Balkans, because we are here and we have been currently hosted by Albanians. And so I try to look to the current situation here. Then some my proposal to grow our community. My and your proposal, because this talk will be probably more debate than a talk. I mean, I would like to have a say. And finally, some GDPR stuff I will quickly explain. This is the current situation in numbers, and please, I know it's unreadable, but I will tell you. This asterisk means that at the moment we don't have so much data from members, and so we have to guess them. That's why the numbers are, roughly, and maybe not so precise, but they are enough for the moment to have a situation, to have an overlook of the situation of our community. So, as of the data of July 17th from the website, you can still not know it, we have 195 members of the foundation. This doesn't mean the community, the foundation. I mean, people who is part of the community, but who also apply to be part of the foundation, and actually, currently, he or she is. The first, stunning data is that we just have about 17 women, which is roughly about 9%. Really few of them. And this is something that we'd like to strive to achieve an increase, and that's why also the LibreOffice group are born. And for the rest, let's say that this is more or less in order of the most member for each country. So Germany is leading, let's say, with 35 members. I didn't calculate the percentage, but the numbers taken itself could be wow, 35. They are the leading. But if we look also to the history, we know that this number is then decreasing. So this doesn't mean that Germany is okay and we don't have to do anything about Germany, because the number has been decreasing. So even in Germany, we should do something to gain back the trust of people and let them become part of the community and most of all part of the foundation. Be aware that the people who is member of the foundation is called, the membership is called Board of Trustees. This means that people who belong to the foundation trust the foundation. And the difference for who doesn't know between a community member and a member of the foundation is that since you are coming, since you give your effort to our project, if you take part of the foundation, you gain the right to vote and to be voted. And so to have your say somehow to the governance of the foundation itself. Then we have 19 members roughly from Italy, and it's all thanks to each other in Italy, who is pushing. not only he, obviously, but he's the leader of our community. It is true. And then we have 13 from Brazil, 9 from France, 8 from India, and more or less 8 from Taiwan. Please correct me, because this asterisk again means that we don't have precise data. And we talk about this later, because we don't ask your country, when you're applying to become a member of the foundation, we don't ask you to supply you so many information. We just ask the main content, because we need to reach you somehow, your name and your surname, and that's it. Okay? So we don't, at the moment, we don't ask any other data. So the one you see is just a guess. And trust me, it is not that easy sometimes, but we see. This is a map made by that man about the coverage, let's say, of the document foundation at the moment. The light green is unreadable, sorry. The light green means that we have people who belong to the community that is not a member of the foundation. While the darker green means that they are both part of the community. Let's say that being part of the foundation implies you are also a member of the community, obviously. So, what are the lacking areas, the missing areas, the missing countries? Surely, all Africa, as you have seen, and the rest of the world, meaning the few countries we should look for. I don't know, which is Panama,
Nicaragua, Honduras, Belize.
And something here. This
No, this is Marcaspio.
Oh,
so it's Azerbaijan, Turkmenistan, Tajikistan.
I just want to see if you were.
I'm a geographer.
Okay. He was going to sleep.
Yes. Azerbaijan, Afghanistan, Turkmenistan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan.
Great. Great. Thank you. Brilliant. Well, so you are still,
you know, don't have anyone in Afghanistan as well. And but of course, I think that there is a different meaning in not having anyone in these countries, and not having anyone, for instance, as a member in these countries, and in these countries, because here they have, let's say that they are developing, and therefore maybe the open source situation in those countries is not as up to the level it is in Europe, or while there is a big open source community in all this, in all South America, in each country of South America, and we badly miss members from Colombia, Ecuador, and Peru. And I mean, there are, I would say the community there is thousands of people. We have people that is working, that is organizing events. So I had a research on different sources. So for instance, in Algeria there is a group of French speaking people that are organizing events, but they do not even think about becoming TDF members, but they organize events. We have Rigoberto here in Peru, he organized a full day event on LibreOffice. And when I asked him why you don't apply for membership, the answer was, what's for? Yeah. So unfortunately, this is the situation. And they, for several reasons, language, which is probably the first, the fact that no one from TDF has ever traveled to these countries. And of course you can say, which is the meaning? I went to Indonesia in February, March, and Franklin was there. But I can tell you, the impression that I had that I was a walking monument in during the conference. You know, people was addressing me like I was a kind of idol, and I mean, I'm a normal person. And Franklin was there, but he's Asian. So my weight, apart from the body weight, was higher than Franklin's weight, because I was coming from Europe. So the fact that I traveled 14 hours to get to Indonesia, the different meaning that he traveled 3 hours. And, you know, it's psychological.
Yeah, it's a
and not different.
It's a fashion of a schedule. Well.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, because Franklin could do it himself what I did there, but the meaning of the person traveling from Europe is a different one. When I was in Taiwan, 1 year and 2 months ago, I was amazed because there were other members of the community that were asking Franklin if they could ask me a question in English. Like, you know, you are a bridge between the idol and the community, and I'm a normal person. People that know me know that I'm a little bit peculiar, but I'm a nice person normally.
Mostly.
So that's, I think this is the issue that we have. We have to talk with these guys, and I think that the speech that by Naruhiko-san is really, we must build a bridge within the local community, and let's call it the central community. There is not a central community, but what is perceived as being the central community.
So, looking at what we are missing, obviously, I just, you know, recap the rest of the world because there are so many countries, but if we focus on it in this area of the Balkans, I saw that we should have 6 people from Albania who are the same who, thanks, I have to say many, many thanks because they are organizing this wonderful conference. 1 from Bosnia, 1 from Romania, 1 from Slovenia, 6 from Turkey, and 1 of them is there, and 2 of them, 3, 4, great. Great, really. And so, there are 15. Not so bad. Probably I should have put here a question mark instead of an exclamation mark, because it's a point of view, obviously. Maybe not so bad, but it's always better to increase and to grow. And again, just like in Germany's situation, this doesn't mean that we don't have to do anything in that area, because it's the opposite. Anyway, we should probably care much. So, but we miss from Bulgaria, from Croatia. On Herzegovina, I just put a question mark because actually the perception is what we call it always called Bosnia and Herzegovina.
The official name is Bosnia and Herzegovina.
Herzegovina. But probably I didn't want to hurt or, you know, someone because maybe feeling some.
There is a gentleman from Sarajevo which is not here today, but yeah. Is from Bosnia and Herzegovina. Is not, is the second conference he attends, is not a member.
Yeah, to remember to push it.
Yeah.
He works in the administration and maybe he wants to feel neutral.
Okay,
but he could be a member.
Yeah. In Kosovo, I've been there to a conference and we had an entire afternoon on LibreOffice, and Kramil Brestovic, who is the organizer, has never asked to be a member. And he ran the workshop together with me. So it's there is probably some misperception of what being a member means or not. For instance, Andrea, we know rather well each other. He contributes to the code.
Yes, but he applied yesterday.
Okay, he applied yesterday because we told him that he would not come back to Italy alive. So, you know, it's this is, but he was not even aware of TDF membership. And he asked 200 and more comments on the code in this year.
Yes, indeed. The problem is also about the knowledge and the recognizement of the membership. What is this membership? That's why I used to explain it always in my speech. And even if this speech is not about what is the membership, I just remarked for who doesn't have. Anyway, yes, North Macedonia and Montenegro, Romania and Serbia, so we're missing from this area. But let's move on. Why do we miss people, do we miss, members from countries? Some of the reasons are roughly been told by itself. Let's say that I tried to get some of these reasons, and but I want to hear from you also. My perception is also, for example, that there is a poor knowledge in general in information technology, and especially in what are the software licenses. This may, to be honest, I mean, I've learned about the software licenses when I was, let's say, already old. But when I was young, when I was, children, I was playing, you know, with computers and so on, I just heard about something that I really didn't care. This could be lack of knowledge or cultural, habits in the country. Maybe also that in a particular country they don't have any revelation or love, which considers a crime to use pirate software. So maybe people is using illegal copy of Windows or Microsoft Office, but they don't care because maybe they don't know, or either it is not a crime in that country. Who knows? So probably they don't know about open source, and then about LibreOffice. So in this case, it's about letting them know those things. So it's about education, and that's what we should address. If this is a reason, but maybe censorship. I don't know, but I don't want to say something wrong. Let's imagine, maybe in China, for example, it is not or forbidden, I guess, but maybe something is, or some website is not reachable.
Yeah, there is also another reason, which is misperception of the contribution to LibreOffice. So I had to convince Franklin to apply for membership 3 years ago, I think.
Yeah, to Shanghai.
And when I went to Indonesia, I met Andika Trividada for the first time, and I said, Andika, you should be a member. And he said, why? I'm not doing nothing. I said, you are localizing in Indonesia all the software by yourself. And I will tell you another thing. Andika at the conference, as Andika has a good job, so for Indonesian standards, he earned a lot of money. He doesn't earn a lot of money, but for Indonesian standards, he earned a lot of money. He bought 20 t-shirts that I brought there, and he gave the 20 t-shirts to students to encourage them to contribute to LibreOffice. And I think that he's a member now, because I told him, I'm not leaving Indonesia if you don't apply for membership.
And since they didn't want
to be there. But I had to insist with him, and his perception is I'm not doing anything, because probably he enjoys doing what he does as a volunteer. But the reality is that even if he enjoys it, he doesn't find it as a burden. I think he deserves to be a member because it's a recognition by the global community, knowing that Andika is doing that incredible job in Indonesia. He has to be recognized, and being a member is not only to show that you are contributing, it's also to for the others to recognize you as a contributor.
And again, it's a way to have a say on the governance.
And by the way, Franklin answered 3 years ago was the same. What I'm doing, he said, you are moving your country to open source. I think it's enough. Yeah, exactly. I think it's enough.
And now, Franklin is part of the board of directors. That's what I mean. He became a member, and then he was voted by most of the people. I mean, he got enough votes. Now he's part of the board of directors. So he's really steering this foundation, at least with a restaurant.
Yes, maybe another misperception is from this professional, because it seems that many of people who contributed in the LibreOffice or other cross LibreOffice services are majorly in professional in the computer science or like electrical engineering or something. But But another field is opinions of people. I dare not to say no, but very, very rare. Like I have no background in computer science. I'm in public administration. But maybe we can play another role, not only the computer science role in the document foundation.
This is also something to be well explained to people. This is more about the community than the membership, but as I said before, it's related. What? You don't have to be an IT person. It could be whatever kind of skill you
have. I'm the best example. I have a degree in literature, and I got it in 1978 when the last T-Rex left Italy.
Wow.
You know, so
but the contribution may be in whatever field, not only IT. We have to translate it, we have to write documentation, we have to make videos, we have to take screenshots, we have plenty of work.
Organize events.
Organize events. Is that encourages people in other fields, like in public administration, maybe like fellows, like literature, to join our community.
Yeah, that's
another, I think, important point.
It's a good point. Good point, because usually people working in the public administration, even if they don't have the decision power, they make inquiries. Or they may see the idea, the verb, let's say.
Another side, I mean, they have this perception is that I'm not in any field of IT, what I can do here. Well, I can do nothing here, and I, quit.
Yeah, that's a point. As I said, we have to address this, explaining how many things you could do, and not necessarily IT things. Not that long ago, not only
or something else.
I would like to have your opinion, but probably we just meet after, because we we're going to be late, I'm sorry about that. This is my proposal to grow our community. As Italo said, have meetings, attend meetings, travel, because the human relationship is something really strong. I think for everybody. For example, I'm part of the membership committee, so I see on my screen all the names, but how much is important to me to meet you at least once per year and give to those names a face, an image, a picture, but more than this, to give a feeling and some life experience. And Franklin knows really what I mean when we went together, we've been together in Maria, for example. We had wonderful time together. Spend time together, have a life experience. This is a key point. This is a key point. The human relationship is always a key point. So, attending and chant during the breaks, for example, approaching people and know each other. This is something really about nurtures and genius and so on. And then, invite locals if you attend an event abroad. Invite locals to join at least at first in our community, and then suddenly after to be a member of the Document Foundation. This is the center of my presentation. Even if it's late, we would like to open. We are thinking about collecting more data, even if in this period is the opposite of the trend, because at least in Europe, because of the GDPR. The trend is to avoid collecting data at all. But we are just thinking about, let's say that this is something academic. We would like to have more data, but for what reason? Let's say to grow our membership and to address, for example, we have seen before, where a country is missing, and we would like to address this and to focus on that countries which is missing, and to do that, we need to know what the country we are missing. The data I've shown you is guessed by him and by me, but it's just guessed. While something different is if you give us more data, we can use statistics and do something more precise. So, for example, something we thought it should be the country most living in, as the map has shown, or on the spoken languages, because we may need, let's say, translated into Spanish, I don't know, Spanish is a bit common, but in a strange language, and maybe someone, let's imagine about Albania. Imagine that in Italy we have lots of Albanian. We may need some Albanian more committer, but they are most of them are in Italy. So it's not about the country, not only about the country you live in, it's also the language spoken. So,
for instance, the leader of the Mongolian community lives in Germany.
Yeah.
In Munich. But he's the guy that localizes in Mongolian and coordinates the localization.
Now
he's Mongolian, of course.
Yes, indeed.
He's married with a German woman, so he moved to Germany.
And that's why. It may be a silly question. Could women please raise their hands? Right, come on. One, two, three. Maybe a silly question, because if I see you, it's obvious to see they are women. But when I have names on screen, it is not that simple. Especially with all the respect, with Asian names. Who knows? Is it male? Is it male? From a certain point of view, this is accessible data, because you may not want to disclose this data to me, and it's respectable. But if we want to grow, we call it the pink ratio, the pink quotes.
To improve diversity.
To improve diversity.
Or provide any services.
Yes, exactly. To address and do this, especially for men. How to do that if we don't know officially. If you officially ask me, how many women do we have in our members, in our foundation? My official answer is, I don't know. Because we can collect such a data. So, the question is, what's your thought about this? What could be the data you think that could help the foundation? Please, have a say.
Some attributions like ethnic or
ethnic.
It will be very sensitive.
Indeed.
Yeah, real problem. So that's very doubling the dilemma. That's a dilemma.
Yes. So we talk about the gender, but the age could be, for example, another interesting data to understand when the membership, when the foundation is getting too old, and when it's time to find new members, young members, for example, to let the foundation be always fresh, let's say, and have new members, because we naturally grow and become older. Really badly, to be honest, really badly.
Some problems while making the questionnaires.
Yes, I guess. But it's people that don't want to disclose anything. And that's the next question. How many of you had some kind of trouble with privacy? Let's say they felt violated because of their data has been published somehow, and they have been frightened by someone else. So just you, Michael? No one else?
Someone else?
Great. Okay. Finally, this is just one two words about that. In Europe, we have this nightmare, which is called GDPR, General Data Protection Regulation. So I won't explain all of them, but let's say being extremely synthetic, the law says that the members, in this case, the people. You have to know and deserve to know what data we have on them and why do we keep them and when, how long we do keep this data. think from what we speak. So that's a challenge. We're working on this because we would like to have more data, but on the other hand, we have such a regulation, which is not only the European regulation, because the regulation is just the answer to a trend, a worldwide trend, to, let's say, have more privacy. The right to the obliviate, is it correct?
Yeah, to oblivion.
The oblivion, sorry, the right to oblivion, because the problem here is that one century ago we didn't have internet, but now we have. And once you write something wherever in the internet, it stays forever, almost. So that's why this worrying, this spilling out, everyone is worried about his or her privacy, and this trend to not disclose any more data. And you know the scandals from Facebook and what was the name of the company, English company?
Cambridge Analytica.
Yeah, Analytica.
So I think we should be so curious about the GDPR, because all about GDPR is that you have to deliver the person who gives the data that he's aware of what he's giving there. So it's not about the question, do I ask this data? It's so be aware that this is in your data. And the next step to give him the possibility to opt out, to say, okay, I want to get out. And this is no reasonable time frame.
Yeah, so I think what we should do is to encourage people to provide more data if they are willing.
Yeah, sure.
And that's all.
Oh, please, at 2:30, let's say after the lunch, we will have a session in track 2 about GDPR. This is something that Uwe, who is someone really skilled on it, and probably Michael, they will give us some kind of instructions on how to move to us, the membership committee. But if you want to attend, you're welcome.